I now want to bring in Dr. Leonard Schleifer, a co-founder, president, and CEO of Regeneron. Dr. Schleifer founded Regeneron in 1988, grew it from a small startup into what is today one of the leading biotech companies in the world, and an intensely science-driven culture. Regeneron has been enormously productive in developing therapeutics across different disease states. And today, importantly, and important, very relevant to this conversation, is at the forefront of finding an effective therapy for COVID-19. So we're delighted to have Dr. Schleifer here with us today to get his perspective on the latest in developments and on the road ahead. Len, it would be great to get your perspective across the therapeutic landscape, but let's focus specifically, if you would, on the antibody strategies in general, and then we'll shift to Regeneron's antibody development candidates.
Sure, thanks for having me, Marshall. Obviously, this is intended to be a informative scientific discussion, but I might make a few forward-looking statements about our program, so note the risk and look at our documents. The whole concept of antibody therapy really is nothing more than trying to imitate what the immune system does. If you think about it, what happens? You get infected with a virus, and your immune system, your adaptive immune system, gets into high gear. And what is it trying to do? It's trying to generate weapons to fight this virus. And because the immune system is so complicated, that is, it has to be able to address things it's never seen before and have a perfect match, that biological selection process and generating these, it's like a random generator, takes time. And it takes weeks. And sometimes, actually, if you measure neutralizing antibodies in patients, they might even not get them even for months. So the immune system is trying its best to come up with things that will smother and neutralize this virus. And it's a bit of a race. Does the virus get you first, or does the immune system save your life? And that's what's sort of going on in the natural world, if you will. What are we trying to do as people developing drugs, vaccines, antibodies, what have you? We're trying to give the body a little bit of an edge. We're trying to, with vaccines, the ultimate weapon, we're trying to get the body to believe it's already been exposed to this virus by giving it a piece of it, a protein of it, a fragment of it, a heat inactivated portion of it, something that tricks the body and saying, okay, we better make some of these weapons. It spends a lot of time making these weapons, finding just the right weapon. And so then when the actual virus infection comes, boom, you're ready to go. You don't have to wait to go through this whole process. So all a vaccine does is it primes up the system very quickly. We can talk in a minute why that's still such a hard thing to do, what the risks are, why it takes so many people, et cetera. But there are other tricks that nature uses to get the immune system going faster than what this normal process is. And the best example of that is a mother and a new baby. A mother will protect her baby in utero by passing antibodies across the placenta. The developing fetus doesn't have an immune system, but viruses might get in, or as soon as the baby's born, the baby might be exposed to a virus. So the mother's pumping in these antibodies in a passive way to get the baby ready to go. Same way right after the baby's born, mother's milk loaded with a lot of antibodies. Why? Because the baby doesn't have an immune system that's ready to go, yet the viruses are out there ready to attack. First Nobel Prize, 1901 in medicine, what was it given out for? Giving a antibody from people who had been infected with diphtheria and in giving it to patients to protect them from diphtheria. That's another example. You talked about convalescent sera. That's another example of giving antibodies. Of course, now we try and use them as therapeutics, and Regeneron has done that with Ebola. We created antibodies in our magical mice. We grew them up through fancy high-tech means, and we gave them to patients before they could make their own antibodies, and we saved their lives. So that's the general concept of antibodies.
Great. Let's talk about Regeneron specifically. Let's talk about you've made huge progress in a very short amount of time. So could you tell us about how you approached it, how you attacked the issue, how you identified and designed these antibodies in particular, how you move quickly into clinical development, and importantly, your strategy. I'd like for the audience to hear more about why a combination, why the antibody cocktail?
Right. Great questions, Marshall. So let's just talk about what we've done. The virus biology, fortunately, of these coronaviruses is sort of well known. It's a ball, if you will, inside this some genetic material, RNA, which is going to be used later when the virus gets inside your cells and hijacks the machinery. But the first job that the virus has is to get inside your cells. And your cells don't like viruses to get inside. So the virus has figured out a way to hijack a ride inside your cell. It binds through this spike protein to something called ACE2. And when it binds that in a very specific way, it just hijacks a ride because the ACE2 is going from the outside to the inside as part of its natural biology. So there you go. You got this spike protein. It's evolved. It binds this ACE2. It goes inside the cell, and then havoc ensues. So what we realize is that we could smother with our magical mice. We don't have time to get into all that. This is the brainchild of my partner, George Antopoulos, who co-founded Regeneron, and he actually thought of this when he was a graduate student, that you could make these mice that make human antibodies. But that's a topic for another day. But we had these antibodies, and you can smother this spike protein, and you can neutralize. And that's exactly what we did with Ebola. We did it in breaking the land speed record in 9 months for Ebola. Now we did it in less than that, in about 5-6 months from hearing about the virus to getting in patients. So we created the antibodies, and we smothered and neutralized them, and that's what we're going to try and do in people. But you asked a really important question, which I'm very concerned about, Marshall, which is, why did we use a cocktail? Cocktail meaning more than one antibody. The reason is we learned and we know that viruses mutate, and they mutate on their own. And we learned from AIDS and lots of other viral treatments that a single antiviral approach, even a single antibody, can result in the selection of a mutant form, an escape form of the virus that will now no longer be sensitive to that antibody. But if you use a cocktail, and these cocktails are hard to come by, it took us a little longer than others maybe who went forward with a single antibody. We went forward only when we had a cocktail because of the following experiment I'm going to tell you about. What does our cocktail do first? It binds to this spike in two different distinct places at the same time. It's almost like grabbing onto a football on opposite ends. You have a good grip on it. And even if one hand slips off because of mutation, the other hand is there. And you see people trying to smother a football. They don't want to drop it. Same thing with these antibodies. And it was hard to find antibodies that would bind simultaneously to different spots in the critical part of this spike protein, the critical part of the virus. And we asked the question in laboratory experiments, and lo and behold, turns out to be the case. If you take a replicating model system, and this was, I think this will be online. These papers have been accepted, published in Science. You can read about them, I think, at 2 o'clock today, where I'll give you a little preview. Basically, if you treat a spike protein with one antibody, you can neutralize it. But you know what happens? Over time, you get these escape variants selected. And sure enough, your cocktail, your single antibody is no good. You use the second antibody, same thing happens. But when you use a cocktail two at a time, that doesn't happen. That's why we were so focused, and we actually think people should look at these papers very carefully. We are worried about single antibody approaches because they could even have downstream impact on our vaccine approaches, because these are another paper in Science that just came out that said where everybody's focusing their antibodies are immunodominant domains. And if you select for mutations, you may lose the benefit of what your vaccine does. So cocktail, much safer, we think much more effective in patients. Hope to get an answer late summer.
Let's talk about the clinical development. So you've embarked upon the clinical development. You have a pretty active full calendar over the next several months. Give our audience a sense as to how and when we're likely to see data, because your program in particular is one that many of us are focusing on and we're all rooting for. So we'd love to know when and how we're going to learn more in the months to come.
Right. Yeah, it's funny that you should say rooting, and I can't resist, even though you might get mad at me, mentioning that I'm viewed as evil pharma because my poor son is running in a congressional race and people are attacking him because he's associated with evil pharma. I hope everybody is rooting for us, and not only rooting for us, rooting for everybody in this industry who's working on vaccines, who's sweating day and night, coming to the labs. I think we all should be rooting for this industry to make a huge difference, because this is a scientific problem, and it's only going to be tamed, but with a scientific solution. So I'm optimistic that the evil pharmaceutical and biotechnology industry will actually rise to the occasion, and this might be a transformational moment. Now, what to expect from our program? We're looking at these antibodies in several different times of the infection. Starting with people in the hospital, people who are really recently infected, and then people who are at risk for infection in a prophylactic high-risk mode. We can't use it as a vaccine and treat hundreds of millions of people because that capacity doesn't exist. But it can function like a vaccine in treating people who are at high risk for infection, or right after infection, or even perhaps later, the way we did with Ebola. Personally, I think the sweet spot, what we should be looking for, is when we get some data late in summer on the newly infected patients. That may be the sort of the sweet spot where there's pretty good evidence. If you want to use antivirals, the earlier you use them, that was seen with Tamiflu. And generally speaking, these are antivirals. If you want to use them early in the process. Look for those data. Look for us to maybe decrease the amount of time that patients are expressing the virus. Maybe that'll decrease the infectivity of people. And look for us to hopefully prevent people from getting really sick or getting sick at all. So that's a lot on our plate coming up over the next several months.
For sure. So my last question, Len, I'm gonna reference two things that you've touched upon in your answers thus far. First is you reference combination or cocktail strategy, which is an approach, a therapeutic strategy that was unquestionably validated in the treatment of HIV. The second thing that you just referenced is the importance of science and innovation. And so in my many conversations regarding this particular pandemic and this crisis, I underscore the fact that in dealing with today's challenge, you have to understand the progress and state of today's scientific acumen. So my question is, you over the past 30 years have built a company and made that investment through sweat equity, through toil, through insight, through a lot of invested capital, as have a number of your peers throughout the industry. And I, for one, have seen the degree and the pace of that innovation. And so I get to look at what you all are doing and have a great deal of confidence and enthusiasm and optimism in it. So I want to give our audience a sense from your perspective, what's changed over the past several decades and even over the past 5 years that can take, if you just reference back to HIV, it took decades to get therapeutics to a state where it truly made for a manageable disease. And yet in that category, we still don't have a vaccine. And so when people say, geez, HIV was such a long slog and a terrible, terrible disease with so much negative impact, how can we go from isolating and sequencing this virus to within 12 months conceivably having effective therapeutics and effective vaccines? Can you just contextualize that for our audience so that people can share, I think, our respective optimism?
Right. It's a great question, Marshall. And you might get depressed if you look at history and say, geez, we're sitting here today without a vaccine for AIDS, as you just said. But I think what's changed is what we anticipate at Regeneron and how we built, all of us at Regeneron built our company, which is we realized that two things were advancing extremely rapidly and in parallel. One was the understanding of basic molecular biology, molecular immunology, medical sciences, diseases, all that sort of good fashioned biological wet sciences, biochemistry, medicinal chemistry, and so forth. That was starting to accelerate at a great speed. But on top of that, if you will, or parallel to that, was this great acceleration of technology. And in fact, if I remember, I'm long enough in this industry since 88, as you said, but in the 90s, people used to be divided up, were you a therapeutics company? were you a technology company? And people sort of a platform company? Could you do make random molecules that you didn't know what they were good for? We always felt that you needed to be at the leading edge of both biology and medicine and technology. And when you're at the leading edge of that, you can do miracles. And it's really miraculous if you think about it, what we do today. I mean, some of our other drugs, we've tamed allergic diseases, at least type 2 inflammation in my mind, by understanding biology and having technology. And that's why we were able to do this with Ebola so quickly, and why we and others who understand both biology and technology, things can move so much faster. New approaches to vaccines, as well as old approaches to vaccines, scaling up, understanding how to make things at higher density. We make our proteins much better than we did 20 years ago. We make them faster. We know how to make antibodies better. We know how to understand the biology. We can get the DNA sequence of the RNA sequence of a new virus like that. We can look at variants. We've checked thousands of variants. You can pick up CNN, which I did, and they said there's a new variant out there. I called the team and they said, oh yeah, we know that. We've checked it. Our cocktail works. The technology is so powerful. And if you combine that with the biology, you literally are at the verge of doing miracles. I'm optimistic the industry will showcase itself. A vaccine will come eventually. I think our therapeutics have a good chance. Other antibody approaches, other antiviral approaches. I think there's a lot going on. We can't overpromise. There's a ways to go, but I am optimistic.
That's very encouraging. And thank you so much for sharing your perspective. It's extremely helpful. And thank you for all that you do, along with your peers in the biopharmaceutical industry. It very much is making a difference. We appreciate your time today. We appreciate your perspective. Thanks so much, Len.